Greetings. We greet you in the matchless and majestic name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank God for the privilege to join the fine members of the Friendship Church via Facebook Live. To all of our Facebook friends, wherever you might be, we greet you this morning. Let me first say happy Mother's Day. This is the day set aside where we honor our mothers who have loved and nurtured, who have made the sacrifices for us. I want all of you to know that we love you. We thank God for the sacrifices you've made for us. Thank God for those times, even when you weren't so nice, but we know it was all for our good. So happy Mother's Day. I pray that everyone here who has a mother that's still alive, that you will reach out and love on your mother. Let them know how very much you appreciate them, and let them know on their special day that you in fact do love them. So we thank and praise God for you. This is another day the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Have a word today that's found in the seventh chapter of the Gospel of Mark. I'm going to say a little prayer and then give you time to find that and then sing. If you don't mind, this morning I'm going to sing one of my favorite songs. Reverend Kim Gladney introduced me to this song, and I am thankful to it. It reminds me of my grandmother and my mother. So pray that you will pray with us today and hope that you'll be helped as this word goes forth. Our Father and our God in heaven, how we thank you for this privilege to once again stand behind this sacred desk and declare the truth of your holy and righteous word. Lord, we love you today. We thank you for allowing us this privilege to see another day. Thank you for this Mother's Day, a day that has been set aside to honor those who gave us life and to the ones who made sacrifices for us and the ones who cleaned us up when we could not even clean up ourselves. So we thank you for the gift of motherhood. Pray today that for every mother, every expectant mother, that this will be a pleasant and a wonderful day, and one that in all we do, we glorify you. Now, God, as we go into your word, we pray that you will bless us, open our eyes, that we'll see, open our ears, that we'll hear, and our hearts, that we will receive that which you have shared with us on this day. Let the words of our mouth and the meditations of our heart be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. This is your servant's prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. I was young, but I recall singing songs. Was grandma's joy as the shadows drew at the close of the day. I would sit on grandma's knee in those days of youth used to be. As she would sing of God's amazing grace. You know my grandmother was so sweet and so kind. She told me She said, Reggie, you won't find, no, not another who can handle your hurt and your pain. So I took her at her word, and I sought the blessed Lord. And now my grandmother's God is mine. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Thank God now I'm found. Were blind, but now I see. Amen. Mark chapter 7, verses 24 through 30. And from the New King James, it reads this way. From there he arose and went to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And he entered a house and wanted no one to know it, but he could not be hidden. For a woman whose young daughter had an unclean spirit heard about him, and she came and fell at his feet. The woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician by birth, and she kept asking him to cast the demon out of her daughter. But Jesus said to her, "Let the children be filled first, for it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs." And she answered and said to him, "Yes, Lord, yet even the little dogs under the table eat from the children's crumbs." Then he, Jesus, said to her, "For this saying, go your way. The demon has gone out of your daughter." And when she had come to her house, she found the demon gone out and her daughter lying on the bed. Amen. God's word for God's people, and I'd like to tag that text this morning with this thought, mother's love, mother's love. Dr. Tony Campolo is a well-known and highly respected inspirational speaker. Over the last several years, Mr. Campolo has spent much of his time traveling around the world on speaking tours. Meanwhile, his wife, Peggy, has chosen to stay home and give herself and all that she has to the bringing up of their two children, Bart and Lisa. On those rare occasions when Peggy does travel with Tony, she finds herself engaged in conversations with some of the most accomplished, impressive, influential, and sophisticated people in the world. After one such trip, Peggy told Tony that sometimes as she visits with these powerful and influential people, she often finds herself feeling intimidated and sometimes questioning her own self-worth. Tony said to her, "Well, honey, why don't you come up with something you could say when you meet people that will let them know that you strongly value what you do and you feel that it is dramatically urgent and crucially important?" Well, not long after that, Tony and Peggy were at a party when a woman said to Peggy in a rather condescending tone, "Well, my dear, what do you do?" And Tony Campolo says he heard his wife say this, "I am nurturing two Homo sapiens into the dominant values of the Judeo-Christian tradition in order that they might become instruments for the transformation of the social order into the kind of eschatological utopia God envisioned from the beginning of time." I think I need to read that one more time. She said, "I am nurturing two Homo sapiens into the dominant values of the Judeo-Christian tradition in order that they might become instruments for the transformation of the social order into the kind of eschatological," there it is, "utopia God envisioned from the beginning of time." And the other woman said, "Oh my, that's impressive. I'm only a lawyer." I like that story because it reminds us that there are many important jobs in the world today, but not one of those jobs are as important than the job of being a good mother. After all, particularly in the age and the day and the time in which we live, who has a better opportunity to shape and influence and impact the lives of our young? Today, we celebrate Mother's Day. The text we read indicates a mother's love and how that love can be expressed in words, in attitudes, and in action. That's precisely what we see in our scripture lesson for today in Mark chapter 7, as this Greek mother seeks out and comes to Jesus looking for help for her daughter. The Bible says her daughter is sick. She's heard about Jesus and she's heard about his power to heal. So as a loving and concerned mother, she decides to approach Jesus, and when she does, she humbly kneels before him and asks him if he will heal her daughter. At first glance, it seems like Jesus is being a bit harsh with this Greek woman because the first words that he utters are, "Let the children first be fed, for it's not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." What in the world could Jesus mean? What did that mean when Jesus uses that terminology? Well, the word "children" that Jesus uses refers to the Jews, and the word "dogs" referred to Gentiles. The Jews regarded Gentiles as an unclean people, and their most notorious term of contempt was to refer to the Gentiles as dogs. This was a reference to those wild, filthy, flea-bitten dogs that often roamed the streets in the days of our text. But interestingly, and don't miss this, Jesus does not use the traditional Gentile word for dogs. In the original Greek, he doesn't use the word for street dogs. Rather, Jesus uses the diminutive word which describes not the filthy dogs of the street, but Jesus refers to the little pet dogs that belong in the house, the family's beloved pet. And he's referring to dogs that were house trained and lived in one's house. And when he did that, watch this Greek woman immediately recognized that Jesus was speaking to her with a low level of sarcasm, that she was with a man who was considering her as a friend, and most importantly, based on Jesus's response, she recognized that help was on the way. This woman was a Greek, and the Greeks in that day had a great love for conversation, for dialogue, and for friendly debate. For we know the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 would declare I don't come to you with flowery words of wisdom. I don't come trying to impress you, but he said, I come and I preach nothing but Jesus Christ and him crucified. The Corinthians loved to dialogue and would often have conversations that never had a final conclusion. And so Paul declares he chooses to know nothing but Christ and him crucified. The Greeks loved to banter back and forth. They loved dialogue. They loved mentally sparring with one another. And not only then, but back then, men would not discuss theological issues with women as Jesus had done with this Syrophoenician woman. Women at the time of the text were treated as inferior. They were often looked at as being mindless beings, as things to be used as chattel, to be owned and discarded. But watch what happens in this text. Jesus honors and he engages this Greek woman by including her or drawing her in to a philosophical and theological discussion. He draws her in with the kind of discussion that was so important in the Greek world of old. And so because of this, because of Jesus' response to this woman's request, the Greek woman understands that Jesus is actually befriending her. And she skillfully arises to the occasion with a brilliant response to Jesus' statement. Listen to what she says. She said, yes, I know the children are to be fed first, but surely I ought to be able to have the crumbs which fall under the table, which the children have thrown away. In other words, your own children, she says, the Jews don't want what you're trying to feed them. Read Mark chapter 6. Jesus loved this woman's response. He liked her spirit. He loved her spunk. Hers was a subtle faith that would not quit and a persistent faith that would not take no for an answer. Here was a mother with a sick child at home who was willing to take a chance by engaging the master and go out on the limb for the sake of her sick child. And when she was tested by Jesus, she responded with grace and grit and with charm and insight. And Jesus was impressed with this mother's response. Jesus immediately liked her. He liked her boldness and he liked her commitment to her child. And Jesus answered this woman's prayer. Listen to what Jesus says. He says, woman, you've answered well. And now you may go your way because your daughter has been made whole. And the Bible says the Greek woman returned home quickly and found that indeed her mission had been accomplished. Just as Jesus has said, her daughter had been completely healed. When she arrives home, the illness is completely gone. Jesus had indeed, according to his word, made her daughter well. Now, this is a fascinating story. And at this point, we could go in a number of different directions. As you look at this text, as you unfold this text, we could look at the power of Jesus to heal. We know that Jesus has healing power. We could look at the impact of this woman's bold persistence and how she persisted in having Jesus to heal her daughter. Or we could talk about how this Greek woman symbolizes all of the Gentiles and their eventual inclusion in the kingdom of Almighty God. But for now, let me invite you just to look with me at the portrait of love that is painted by this mother in this text. in this Greek mother's encounter with Jesus, we see three of the most important ways that any mother can express love for a child. First of all, we see a mother's love expressed by words. Love can be expressed, brothers and sisters, by simple words. The Greek woman came to Jesus that day to express in words her love for her sick child. And also, you don't want to miss this, in the whole Gospel of Mark, she is the only person in the entire Gospel of Mark, she's the only person who lovingly calls Jesus her Lord. It seems like it would be easy to express our love with words, but the truth is, precious few people are really able to express in words their love for one another. Why is that, and why do we have so much trouble speaking words of love? I believe today that if we realized how very powerful words are, I think that we as a people should work harder at the task of expressing our love with simple words. Some years ago, the story's told, a woman was dying in a local hospital. She was in her mid-80s, and she had a son, and her son flew in to be with her at her sick bedside. He walked over to the bedside of his dying mother, leaned over, kissed her on the cheek, and then, touched by the tender moment that he was sharing with his mother and seeing her so weak and so vulnerable in a state of transition, he said to her, "Mom, you've been such a good mother to me, and I want you to know how much I truly love you." And tears began to roll down this sick woman's face. And she looked that boy in the eye and said, "Son, that's the first time you've ever expressed in words that you really love me." She reminded him, last Friday was his 63rd birthday, and that's the first time in 63 years that you've ever told me you love me. Now, isn't that something? It took this son 63 years to say to his mother the simple words, "I love you." And let me ask you something this morning, those of you that are listening. Is there a word of love that some of you need to speak to someone in your life today? Are you taking for granted that those around you automatically know that you love them, and yet you have not expressed your love in words? Is there anyone today that you need to get them on the phone or look them in the eye and tell them, "I love you"? Listen, for those of you that are fortunate enough to still have your parents, to still have your mother around, how long has it been since you've told your mother or even your father how much you really love them and how much you appreciate them? You may not see eye to eye all the time, but they brought you in this world, and there was a time when you could not take care of yourself. They nurtured you and brought you along the way, and you need to express love for your parents. How long has it been since you told your mate, your brother, your sister, or someone who means something to you that you really love them? Now, I don't mean this quick routine, matter of fact, "I love you," but I mean a real heart-to-heart expression of your love in words. And then to the parents, to the mothers that are out here today, how long has it been since you told your children how proud you are of them? And how long has it been since you told them you cherish them and you told them that you love them? Let me suggest something. For 1 week, you need to write down every word you say to your children and then ask, how many of these words are words of love, encouragement, and appreciation, and not just words of correction or words of discipline? And I know sometimes as parents, I've got two children, God bless them, love both of them. I know as parents, sometimes we have to be referees, and that's a loving thing to do. But there are also times we need to be cheerleaders for our children and let them know how much we love. We need to tell our children and those close to us how much we really love them. There's no question about it. One of the best ways to express love is to do it in words. And this woman, who was a Greek, who was non-Jewish, expressed her love for her sick daughter when she approached Jesus and asked him to heal her daughter. Not only is there a possibility of expressing your love with words, but secondly, you can also express love through your attitude. We can express our love with our attitude toward life. One of the things about the Greek woman that impressed Jesus most was her attitude. She was committed to her child, and she was willing to do whatever it took to get help for her sick daughter. She was bold in approaching Jesus. She was determined. She was persistent. And she was courageous because she lived with the attitude of love. She refused to be put off, even though Jesus used a level of sarcasm. She would not be discouraged. She refused to give up because she lived by the attitude of love. And when I think about that, I'm reminded of the story of Ruth. Naomi, her mother-in-law, had left Jerusalem and traveled to Moab because of a famine in the land. In the course of time, Naomi had lost her husband as well as both of her sons. And one of those sons was Ruth's husband. With no means of surviving, the Bible says Naomi decided to go back to Jerusalem and live the remainder of her life there as a widow. But as she was leaving, Ruth, because of Naomi's example before her and because of Naomi's lifestyle before her, Ruth said, "Wherever you go, I'm going. I want your people to be my people, and I want your God to be my God." And as a result of Ruth's love for her mother-in-law, Naomi, and Naomi's love for Ruth, the Bible teaches us that Ruth fits into the lineage of King David, and it all was a result of her love for her mother-in-law. Now, as cliche-ish as it may sound, it is still profoundly true. Love is the answer. So we would do well to hold on to that and to live by an attitude of love. As Christians, brothers and sisters, as mothers, that is our calling, to live always by the Spirit and the attitude of love. We can express our love with words, but we can also express our love with attitude. Finally, this Syrophoenician woman teaches us that we can also express love with our actions. This Greek mother in Mark chapter 7 not only talked about it, not only had the right attitude, but she put her love to work. She acted out her love. She expressed her love with actions. And how important that is for our children to actively demonstrate and to show the love that we have for those that God has blessed us with. The story is told about a girl from Sarawak, Borneo. Her name was Annie Wong. Her grandfather had been a headhunter, and when she was in high school, Annie Wong went one night to a youth program led by a Methodist college student. That night, after hearing the gospel and hearing the good news, her heart was moved, and Annie accepted Christ and was converted as a child of Almighty God. She accepted Christ as her Savior, dedicated her life to him, but then she had a problem. How was she going to tell her parents about this newfound faith? She decided that she could not possibly express it to them in words. They did not believe in Christianity, but rather she decided that she was going to show them this newfound faith through her deeds of love. And here's how Annie described what happened. She said, "Before Christ came into my life, I was spoiled. I was a very selfish child." She says, "I was irritable and I was impatient. I was often very disrespectful to my parents. My room was constantly a mess. and my attitude was worse than my room. She says, but after Christ came into my life, I was a changed person. I became kind to my parents. I voluntarily cleaned up my room. I helped and volunteered to help with the housework, and I spoke with tenderness and respect toward my parents. I was loving toward everyone that I came in contact. And after a while, my parents noticed the change, and they said to me, Annie, you are very different. What has happened to you? Why has this wonderful change taken place in your life? Annie says, she said to her parents, yes, I am different because I have been born again. I've been reborn. I now serve Jesus Christ as my Lord and my Savior. I'm a Christian now, and Christians always live by the law of love. And her parents very eagerly looked at her and said, tell us more about this religion. Tell us more about this Christ. If he can change people like that, we want to be Christians too. Well, brothers and sisters, that's the way it works. We can express our love with words. We can express our love with attitude, but most powerfully and most dramatically and most meaningfully, we can express our love with actions. So on this Mother's Day, as I prepare to close, I pray that the Lord will help us to remember the love that was demonstrated by this desperate mother in Mark chapter 7. She demonstrated her motherly love. She did it through her words. She spoke boldly to the Christ. She did it with her attitude. She acted out on what she believed. But most of all, she expressed love with her actions. And I would say to you today on this Mother's Day, let us do likewise. Children, express love to your parents. And parents, express love to your children. Happy Mother's Day. May the Lord bless you. If you're watching us today, we pray that you've been touched by something said in this message. If you are watching us, and like little Annie Wong, who heard the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, if you've not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, what a great day to make a decision. May the 10th, 2020, make a decision that you're going to allow Jesus to come into your life and be Lord of your life, so that that wonderful change that took place in Annie Wong's life can take place in your life. Wherever you are, whatever you're doing, it doesn't matter what you did last night, doesn't matter where you've been, you can be saved today if you will trust Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. So watching us via Facebook Live, YouTube, whatever it might be, you can just simply stop right now, bow your head, and pray this prayer with me. If you have not accepted Jesus Christ, just pray this simple prayer with me. Lord Jesus, I realize that I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. I've sinned and fallen short. And Lord, I ask you to forgive me of my sin, and I invite you into my life. Lord, I repent of my sins and want you to be Lord of my life. Thank you, Jesus, for coming into my life. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Listen, if you're with us, if you've prayed that prayer, if you were sincere, if you want a change of heart, if you want a change of direction, and you prayed that prayer, according to your testimony, you're saved right now wherever you are. I would encourage you to find a Bible teaching, a Bible preaching, and a Bible believing church. Find a church. Let the pastor know that you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and they will receive you into the membership. If you don't have a pastor, we would certainly love to hear from you here at the Friendship Church. You can reach us 773-378-6600. We're not in the office all week, but we're checking the phone. You leave a message and leave a way we can contact you. We will certainly respond to your call. If you would like to email us, you can email FBC, Friendship Baptist Church, FBC Chicago at yahoo.com. Let us know your intentions and we will receive you. Maybe you're watching us, you don't have a church home, and right now because of this pandemic, we don't have a place that we can gather, but that day will soon, it will eventually, I won't say soon, it will eventually come. You're welcome to join us here at the Friendship Baptist Church. You can also call us 773-378-6600 to let us know your desires, your intentions to unite with us, or you can email us at fbcchicago@yahoo.com. It is our prayer today that through this message, someone will be encouraged to reach out to that mother, to that guardian, to that person that had such an impact on your life, that made sacrifices along the way. Reach out to let them know how much you love and how much you appreciate them. Brothers and sisters, I say again, happy mother to all of the mothers that are out there, to the many women that have nurtured and loved on me down through the years, corrected me when I was wrong, made sacrifices, who have contributed and poured into my life. I want you to know that I love each and every one of you, and I pray God's blessings upon you. I say again, happy Mother's Day. We're going to have a few announcements. Again, thank all of the mothers. Call somebody. Make it your duty today to call someone. Tell them happy Mother's Day. This week on Thursday, let me announce to those that are watching, on Thursday is First Lady Detra Backus's birthday. Amen. I won't say how old she is. I'll let her do all of that. But it's her birthday Thursday. May the 14th is her birthday. We're going to have a virtual birthday party, a Zoom celebration, so that all of you that would like can wish her a happy birthday. If you would like to send her a card, if you would like to show her an expression of love, just you can mail it to the Friendship Church, 5200 West Jackson Boulevard. Make it attention, Detra Backus, D-E-T-R-A, Backus. You make it to her attention. Most of you who have our church directory, have our home address. If you would like to show an expression of love, please send it to either to the home address or here at the church. Detra Backus certainly loves this church, and she works hard behind the scene, and I'm sure that she would appreciate your acknowledgement of love for her birthday. Amen. So we will send out the Zoom information by Tuesday of this week. You'll have it 2 days in advance. We'll send it out Tuesday so that you will know the time and the password for the Zoom virtual birthday party. And we hope that you will join us to wish her a happy birthday. Weekly events. Thank you for joining us today on Mother's Day for our 11 o'clock a.m. worship. Hopefully you were able to watch our Sunday school hour, which is from 9:30 to 10:30, this very same venue through Facebook Live. Each Tuesday morning, we have a prayer call at 8 o'clock a.m. That prayer call is, the number is 712-775-7085, and we will display the access code. We don't want to just put it out so anyone could get it. We'll make sure the access code is on our website, but you'll have that number, or you can call the church or call Reverend Davidson and get that access code. Every Tuesday and Friday, our youth ministry has a Zoom youth ministry meeting led by our youth pastor, Reverend Tommy Savage, who is doing a marvelous job with our youth. I joined in on the youth call myself this past Tuesday and was excited. Several of the children were on there, and they were talking about prayer and many other things, and he's engaging our young people. So we want you to join in. Any of our youth that would like to be a part of the youth ministry, you can also leave a message here, or you can reach out to Reverend Savage through our fbcchicago@yahoo.com email. Bible study, our Bible studies, Wednesday nights at 6 o'clock p.m. You can also see that on Facebook Live. And we would encourage you, those that would like to give, we have four ways for you to give. You can send your gift via Cash App. Our young people are in love with Cash App. They don't carry cash. You can just simply Cash App $ Friendship Chicago. It will go directly into our account. You can give online our webpage at fbcchicago.org. Up in the upper right-hand corner, there is a giving tab, and you can help support this ministry. You can also give through your smartphone. Pull up a message and text to this number, the number 773-992-1462. In the message box, just type the word give. It will immediately send you back a link, and you can go through the process, set up an account, or do a one-time gift, however you choose to do that. But you can very easily give through your smartphone. And finally, the U.S. Postal Service is still working. We're still getting many of your contributions through the mail. We thank God for those that have sent them. You can also send it to 5200 West Jackson Boulevard. Again, I want to wish all of you a happy Mother's Day. God bless each one of you. It is my prayer that God will continue to keep you, and God will bless you with his comfort and with his peace.